So erectile rehabilitation is a name which we have affectionately given to men who we are trying to preserve and actually reinvigorate their erections. And routinely we use it after some type of definitive therapy for their prostate cancer. And in particular, we use it for men after their robotic prostatectomy. So let's talk about what I routinely recommend for my patients. Now, number one is that there are a fair number of patients who, within a very short period of time after surgery, they regain their erections actually pretty quickly, which is great. But unfortunately, not all men actually just, start doing fantastic right after surgery. However much we'd love to believe that as surgeons, it just doesn't work that way. So what we look at is we try to make sure that we're preserving that erectile function and actually reinvigorating that erectile function. So how do we do that? So part one is that we want to make sure that we are helping those nerves actually get stimulated. And the way we do that is, number one is routinely I recommend phosphodiesterase inhibitors. Now, whether it's going to be a daily Cialis, now phosphodiesterase inhibitor is a Viagra, a Cialis, Levitra, and there's a new one out called Stendra. And what these medications do, you have to understand how they work, is that the nerves that actually run right alongside the prostate, what they do is they actually will release a chemical. And that chemical is released inside the penis, and that actually causes the vasodilation, which is the blood flow actually in the penis. So, people have this misinterpretation that they take a Viagra, they can be sitting on the couch, and all of a sudden they get an erection. That's not the way it works. And I will countlessly tell patients, when you take a Viagra, you got to do something to make the erections work a little bit. You can't just sort of hang out and eat a bowl of soup and kind of hope things will happen. So the way that you do that is you have to get somehow stimulated, whether that's going to be a visual stimulation or whether it's going to be a tactile, in other words, a touch stimulation. So at the end of the day, a phosphodiesterase inhibitor actually helps preserve. So when those nerves actually release that chemical causes that blood flow, and that blood flow will increase, and then it causes the erection. So what we want to do is we want to increase the amount of that chemical that actually stays around longer. So when a man gets stimulated, again, that erection gets better. So Viagra, Cialis, Levitra, Stendra, what have you, they don't cause the erections, they make your erections better that you have. So we want to make that erection better. And the way we do that is we start that in. And I usually start for patients, a fair number of patients, I actually started on actually prior to surgery. And I do that because we know that the better erections they have going into surgery, the better erections they're actually going to have coming out of surgery. So then, and then shortly thereafter, we put them back on that. And again, a lot of that depends on whether a patient has had side effects from one of those medications. A lot of times I'll use daily Cialis. I like it. There's some interesting data that actually says that it can actually help. So that's from a phosphodiesterase inhibitor wise. So we want to, again, get those nerves releasing that chemical to actually get those nerves actually start functioning and get blood flow in there. A second thing routinely we do is what's called a vacuum erection device. And a vacuum erection device is a pump that goes on the penis. A lot of people make jokes about these, from Austin Powers, and it's not my penis pump. And at the end of the day, it's a pretty funny, topic of discussion. There's no doubt about it. But what it does is it pulls blood flow in the penis. And what we know about that is that it's particularly important to actually get blood flow in there. And what we think is that it minimizes the effect of scarring in the penis. So if we're not getting full erections right after surgery, we know that the sooner that we actually start activating that, and sooner we actually get blood flow in the penis, the less chances we have of actually scarring in the penis. My analogy to that is very similar to a rubber band. So if you have a rubber band and you stretch out that rubber band and it's working fine, well, great. If I leave that rubber band sort of like, out in the yard for 2 or 3 months and then I try to stretch that rubber band, well, what happens? That rubber band just doesn't stretch out as much. Well, as an analogy wise, we want to make sure that that penis is actually stretching out so we're minimizing any scarring tissue, and that's what the vacuum erection device does. A lot of times too, depending on how we're doing with the erectile function, we actually recommend injection therapy, which if you think you're talking about, using a pump and things, and then you start talking about needles in the penis, that really gets, men's attention. They go, come again? Like, did you really just tell me I'm going to put a needle in my penis? And the answer is yes, and here's the reason why. Because depending on those erections, we want to actually make sure that we're actually getting oxygenated blood flow to the penis. And the way that we do that is we actually have a small little needle that goes in the side of the penis, and it actually causes that direct vasodilation. So it's sort of like Viagra going directly into the penis, but it actually causes a direct vasodilation. We bypass the nerves for that. And again, we don't do it on all men, but we do it on specific men who we want to get those good erections back, sooner when it's taken them a little bit longer. But it's particularly important to do that, again, because we want to minimize that scarring in the penis, we want to get oxygenated blood flow in there, and again, we want those nerves and we want that penis to actually start, functioning the way it should do again. And then on top of all of those things, you know, I tell men it's important to actually we do some kind of cardiovascular activity, and then we really look at their diet. You know, I think it's really important that we just get men back to, you know, really trying to eat as healthy as possible, because what happens is that for men, what happens is you start having a slightly right after surgery, you get a little bit of shortening of the penis. So we want to actually preserve that. And one of the challenges we have, if a guy's not in the greatest shape, you get a little fat pad, and that what ends up that happening is that penis actually will look smaller, and they say, well, what am I going to do with that? And at the end of the day, we're going to do all those things that we talked about, but we're also trying to get in the best shape possible so that penis actually looks like it has more length. All of those things will help. And I do all these things with my patients. And the more aggressive they are early on, then we know that the better off they're going to be. We know that there's great studies that erections will continue to improve for 4.5 years after surgery. Well, we don't wait that long. And the reason why we don't wait that long, number one, is the fact that the sooner we start becoming proactive with the erectile function, the better off they're going to be long term. So if we actually start working on this in the first, you know, 6 weeks to 3 months, they're going to be that much better as opposed to us waiting a year or 2 years down the road. Because again, think of that rubber band. If that rubber band has potentially got a little bit of scar tissue on it, it becomes much more challenging for that to work.
Some prostate cancers are high risk, aggressive, and more likely to spread. Others are low risk, least likely to have bad outcomes. The biopsy says cancer, but current diagnostic tools provide limited information about how aggressive a man's individual disease is. So most men decide to treat prostate cancer immediately. Once treated, many men experience serious long-term side effects, like incontinence and sexual impotence. Immediate treatment isn't always needed. But right now, a man can't be sure if his cancer is the kind that is likely to require treatment or if he's okay to wait for now. What if there was a test that could determine how aggressive prostate cancer is? Genomic Health is developing a new test to do just that. By reviewing the underlying biology of the tumor and using genes from multiple biologic pathways, the test can predict the aggressiveness of prostate cancer when diagnosed, allowing a man to make a more informed treatment decision with confidence, taking care of himself with more information and greater peace of mind.